It's like a religious rite for anyone raised in Texas. You roll into the gas station, look gorgeous, and pump your large vehicle to the brim with that sumptuous, glistening gas that turned the state into an energy empire. Smell that. It's a rush of petrochemical pheromones straight to the brain. The blessing of oil has given Texas many wonderful things. The great fracking prairies of West Texas, J.R. Ewing, Enron. And of course, the petro paradise of Pasadena, with its chemical factories that celebrate humanity's ability to harness and then dominate nature. Imagine my surprise then to learn that right here in Houston, there were people like this. A pair of anti-petro hippies. These two guys say they can make things like fertilizers and cleaning products and plastics without any oil or natural gas at all. And they say they can do it at this factory, which, if you believe them, does not produce 1 ounce of waste. In honor of Jerry Jones and all that Texas considers holy, I decided to investigate this place and these bold claims. I busted right on in to Solugen. Because Houston is awesome, it doesn't really believe in zoning laws. You can drive through a neighborhood like this and then run smack dab into a chemical plant. In this case, the headquarters of Solugen. The company has raised more than $420 million so far and counts noted science expert Leonardo DiCaprio as one of its investors.
Tell me the big idea. Nobody's ever heard of synthetic biology or any of this stuff before. What's the very core thing you guys are going after?
Yeah, I think like there's a few ways to think about what we do. At the simplest level, the question that we want to answer is how do we use carbon dioxide to make valuable chemicals and materials that we interact with every day?
The star of the show here is something that Solugen calls a Bioforge. The big idea behind all this machinery is this. You feed some enzymes with corn syrup, and because they're special enzymes, they kick off useful molecules that can be refined and then used for all sorts of tasks. In short, you're making chemicals, but using corn instead of oil or gas to produce them. As Solugen sees it, its technology strips a lot of steps out of the chemical making process. And most importantly for Mother Earth, eliminates all the noxious waste of traditional chemical manufacturing.
I actually grew up in Houston, and Pasadena is not that far away, and it's famous as like this chemical industry town, sort of notorious for the smells and things that come out of there. So, if I think about the traditional chemical process, what goes into that and why is it notorious in some ways for all the waste products?
If you think about a chemical plant like the plants in Pasadena that you grew up with, all they're really trying to do is convert a feedstock into a valuable product.
And when you guys talk about feedstock, that's just the base thing that you're starting with.
The raw material.
The raw materials.
And the problem with the traditional chemicals industry is you can't convert your feedstock directly to the product. What happens is you make this alphabet soup of other side products, these toxic emissions, all the smells, all these waste streams. So really what the Solugen innovation is, Gorb and I coming together, is about, okay, well, what if you could convert a feedstock directly to a product?
What Solugen is claiming is that it has developed a completely new way of making chemicals that's both more efficient than conventional methods and almost disturbingly pollution-free.
Okay, so sugar, water, carbon go in, and then what comes out at the end?
Our products,
The product, and is there water waste, but it's kind of cleaner? It's just
zero,
the products.
Just products.
Okay, so there's like nothing else
coming
out.
That's the beauty of like the insight that we had was just like, you'll have no air emissions, no water. It's a huge advance.
Because of like CRISPR and
precisely.
Just
we
being able to
edit
change the DNA.
Exactly,
of an
change the DNA and then fundamentally the enzyme in a way that lets it do things we want.
My tour of Solugen began in its labs. The scientists here must discover new enzymes that will perform certain tasks and then figure out how to grow and feed them.
This is where we actually engineer those enzymes. Okay. There's the physical wet lab space, but then we've got a server in Germany that is running millions of computations on this little enzyme to figure out how do we keep optimizing it to make it better for that reactor. Once we've designed that enzyme, we now have to express it at high enough titers that we can use it in our industrial processes. This is a small version where we actually ferment the proteins. And the way we do that here is we let it live in this fermenter, yeah. And we feed it its nutrients, let it grow. And as you can see, this started like pretty clear. But see how it's dark now? That means the protein is starting to express really, really well. Everything else that you see here is downstream processing to separate that protein out and isolate it so we can put it into the reactor. Yeah.
It all sounds easy enough now, but Gaurab and Sean have been on a long and winding journey to figure this stuff out.
How did you two meet and come up with this idea in the first place?
People think we made this story up, but we didn't, right? So like, I'm actually a physician scientist, studied cancer biology, discovered really cool like reactions that make molecules in cancer, started with hydrogen peroxide. And Sean was at MIT doing his chemical engineering PhD on the production of hydrogen peroxide at massive scales using metal catalysts, right? Yeah.
So we're working on the same problem, but just from
enzymes,
two different angles.
Metals, right?
It's always just a story of luck, like lucky that we met, lucky we had this idea. Then what was really lucky is our first customer saw our pitch to MIT and they said, hey, if you make this, we'll buy it. And so actually like we loaded our first product in the back of my Subaru and we drove it to our customer in Dallas.
Like a tank of something?
It was just 1 gallon bottle. It was a mixture of gluconic acid and peroxide that we called bioperoxide.
So you'd be used for?
For cleaning hot tubs.
Okay.
Yeah, so we just drove over.
It was not glamorous, actually.
No.
There was nothing glamorous about this.
But the best part
is
like we thought it was amazing. So like we made this first sale and then I told my dad, I was like, I'm gonna quit my job. And she was like, you made
like how big was the sale? $200.
And this machine, so this is like the first thing that
you guys
worked on.
Yeah. So this is the original one. We've got, I don't know why that's there.
But that's not part of the...
multiple times people have tried to throw this away. But yeah, no, Gorb and I, we hand-built this system.
With this particular machine, when you were trying to develop the enzyme and your technique, there was just like nothing like this that you could buy.
So there are no enzymatic reactors.
Okay.
So yeah, you can't go into Google and be like, I want to buy an enzymatic reactor. Yeah.
And where did you build this? In somebody's apartment or?
We rented some lab space behind Love Field Airport in Dallas. We rented some lab space and then this was built from Home Depot parts. We actually had to take out ceiling panels in the lab to fit it in.
How long did it take you to do that?
I would say this was probably a 2 or 3 week build.
And now these guys' bizarre machines are all grown up and rather spectacular.
And so this is the first commercial Bioforge.
All the extra piping and everything, I mean, what's going on all around us on the sides?
From any point in the plant, you can essentially send material anywhere else in the plant.
Okay.
This is how you build a zero discharge facility with no waste stream. This is corn syrup. I kind of jokingly say that this tank contains 10 million calories.
10 million calories.
It's 10 million calories, yeah. So once it works its way through the entire plant,
then
our end product is stored in these tanks. And so we can essentially take our core ingredients, blend them with the material in these blue tanks, and then ship finished goods into the concrete industry, into ag, and into water treatment.
How'd you know that's supposed to go off?
I built this.
Much of what happens in this jungle of pipes relies on Solugen's new age enzymes, but some of the action requires old-fashioned chemistry in the form of metal catalysts. It's the metals and enzymes combined that let the company make just about any chemical known to man.
Plastics, so gasoline, whatever you want to make.
Yeah.
It depends on what type of catalyst you touch. Here, can make a completely different product profile as this catalyst. Like if you come to me as a customer and say, hey, I want to make nylon.
Yep.
There is a catalyst in there that when paired with an enzyme can make nylon, the starting precursor to nylon. And so that's the beauty of kind of what we're doing is like, we've got this suite, hundreds of enzymes, hundreds of metal catalysts. Now it's just mixing and matching based on what customers need to make the product that they want.
One of the biggest promises behind this technology would come from sucking carbon right out of the atmosphere and injecting it into the Bioforge as feed instead of the corn syrup that they're currently using. Soligen thinks it knows how to do this and is in the midst of perfecting its techniques.
Basically, that plant out there, it makes about 10,000 metric tons of product, but it removes about greater than 30,000 metric tons of carbon dioxide, which is pretty remarkable on a mass balance basis. How can we use synthetic biology and marry it with traditional petrochemistry techniques? Because we need both of those things to really capture the essence of using CO2 as a feedstock. We're working with the corn soy now, which is a great CO2 sink, but the reality is where we want to go is how do we just take that CO2 from the air and make the things that we want? Yeah.
The Bioforge only opened a couple of months ago, and some of the claims around it seem somewhere between bold and the stuff of green tech fantasy. Soligen, though, is actually making things already and does have some paying customers.
Our chemicals are used in like concrete and building material and like wood glues, so like all the boring things that make up the world around us. It turns out some of those chemicals that are used are not super safe, but we might have an opportunity to replace them with safer bio-based options. Because this is like the tip of the iceberg. If you look at what you can do with the Bioforge concept, you can go after 90% of the molecules in the chemicals industry.
Since I grew up in Houston, I knew what needed to happen next. It was time to engage in the great tradition of eating Tex-Mex food. It would be through the power of queso and margaritas that I would learn how this whole Soligen thing began, with Sean and Gaurab running a rickety early version of the Bioforge all by themselves, Walter and Jesse style.
You know, I mean, it just seems like this must have been a crazy experience to be doing the Breaking Bad thing and kind of seeing where it was going to, just imagining where it would go.
We were really just two guys running this old PVC reactor. Like, I remember one night in the lab, I mean, we were behind Lovefield Airport, a pretty seedy area. Like, we were just working and someone threw a bowling ball through the window.
The question is, like, where'd they get the bowling ball?
Yeah, it's so specific, very, like...
At that beginning stage, was this kind of, you're seeing
of, like,
where it was going to go, or you're like, we're going to make a huge...
No, it was trying not to run out of money.
Yeah.
But were you thinking this could be a chemistry company, or was it just we're onto something interesting?
I mean, if we allowed ourselves to dream the dream,
It's interesting, because it's not that there was any particular aha moment. Like, I would say at the beginning, it's like, I think we were doing it because we really liked the science. We submitted, I think, with 50 patents in 2020 alone.
I know you guys are in a business and you're in this to like make money. Yep. You've discovered this cool thing, but isn't this a little bit like when people, you know, if you guys are successful as you kind of hope to be, and this does as much good as it could, wouldn't people be upset if you guys have the monopoly on all these recipes and processes?
I totally get that. Yeah. And I think that's where we think a little bit bigger, right? Where it's like, well, what if, I always use this example, it's a silly example. Airbnb is the largest hotel, but it doesn't own a single property. Uber is the largest cab fleet, doesn't own a single cab. What if there's a future where we are the largest chemical company, but we actually end up not owning many chemical assets eventually, and we give people access to these things, and so democratize access to like this technology, so anyone can enable it and access it?
These hippies do not have the I'll drink your milkshake ethos of the best Texans. But they do seem smart and well-intentioned. If the great Roger Staubach will forgive me, I'll even wish them the best of luck.